Scientifically, it has been seen, it has been proven that sleep loss has numerous devastating effects on our brain, which links to neurological and psychiatric disorders. It also has devastating effects on every physiological system of our body. And then it further links to other physiological diseases and disorders. What's up you guys, Aditi, welcome back to our channel. Today is another video in our sleep series. Let's look at how, like, what happens to us in our body when we don't get proper amount of sleep, which is 8 to 9 hours scientifically. So let's see what it is today. Let's start with something extreme. There are many ways in which lack of sleep or sleep deprivation can kill you. Some take time, whereas some are more immediate. Let's say something like drowsy driving, like you're sleep deprived and you're driving. So when we don't get enough sleep, which is 8 to 9 hours of sleep scientifically, like I've already said, if you don't get that much amount of sleep, the first thing that kind of lacks, or our body lacks, or we can't do anymore, is focus and being attentive. That's one of the first things that we just poof, gone. We can't do it anymore because we don't get enough sleep at night. So if drowsy driving wasn't the best example for you, then let's talk about us students who study late at night. I am also guilty for it, and I'm trying to change my habits. Pulling all-nighters and staying up at night and studying, that's the best example I can give you for lack of concentration and attention. I'm sure there have been many studies done on this, but one study that I found was done by David Dings. I don't know how to pronounce his surname. We're going to stick to David. He's from university in Pennsylvania. He did a study on a simple attention test to measure concentration. So what he said was that you must press a button in response to a light that appears on a button box or a computer screen within a set period of time. So your response time and the reaction time of your response will be measured. Thereafter, another light comes on and you do the same thing. So the lights appear in a very unpredictable manner. Sometimes it's going to be fast, sometimes it's going to be slow, so you cannot predict it. And it sounds easy, right? I mean, it's supposed to be, but imagine doing this for 14 days at a stretch for 10 minutes. This is what David did. David and his research team did. They got a large number of subjects, and first they made them have the total 8 hours, 9 hours of sleep, so they're fully rested before the test. And then this large number of subjects were divided into 4 different experimental groups. One group was kept up for 72 hours straight, going without sleep for 3 consecutive nights. The second group was allowed only 4 hours of sleep each night. The third group was given 6 hours of sleep each night. And the fourth group was the lucky group. It was allowed to keep sleeping total 8 hours a night. So there were total of 3 key findings. First one was that although because of being sleep deprived, they could not respond in time. There was like their response time was slowed, but David also found that some even missed the response, like they did not respond at all. This doesn't seem like a big thing, but if I have to give you a real life example, then something like maybe your child or maybe your baby brother, baby sister just runs on the street in front of a coming car, you know, like it just runs in front of a street behind a ball in front of a coming car, and you just don't respond in time. You don't run behind the baby, or you just don't catch it and you just bring it back. You just lose that response time. So you can realize how important the attention and your focus is. Now, the second key finding was that the individuals who slept 8 hours every night maintained a stable near perfect performance across 2 weeks. Whereas those in 3-night total sleep deprivation suffered catastrophic impairments. They missed their missed responses or their lack in concentration was increased by 400%. And the surprising part is that these impairments kept on escalating rapidly night after night. And the third key finding was given to us by Dr. Gregory Bilinski at Walter Reed Army Institute of Research. They also tested 4 groups of participants, but they were given 9 hours, 7 hours, 5 hours and 3 hours of sleep across 7 days. So the third key finding I think is the most harmful of all, because when these subjects were asked after woken up or after working all day and not getting proper sleep, when they were asked if they had to rate or if they have to guess, they have to give a sense of how impaired they think they are because they did not get much sleep, they kind of said no, we just feel fine. Which is exactly the way a drunk person feels in a bar when he gets his car keys after more than a few drinks and says, oh, I'm gonna drive home because I don't feel drunk at all. It's pretty much the same thing. Sleep depriving and driving and drinking and driving is as much as the same thing. Both are really, really dangerous. In 2016, AAA Foundation, which has its headquarters in Washington, D.C., they did a study with 7,000 drivers for a period of 2 years. And this is what they found. This study showed us this bar graph, which is just flabbergasting. Each hour of sleep lost amplifies the likelihood of a crash happening. So, don't drink and sleep deprived driving, kids. So, it's not just with our concentration, focus, and attention. Even our emotions go crazy. We go crazy. Our emotions just have a havoc because of insufficient sleep. And we have seen this in babies, right? Sometimes the mother or the parents say, oh, kal raat ko theek se neend nahi aayi. I mean, if that happens in babies, why do you think we would change just because we are an adult and because our hypothalamus has all developed? Why would that change biologically? Another study was conducting using MRI brain scanning. So they found that amygdala is a part in our brain which actually triggers emotional responses such as fear and rage, and also gets triggered and it also triggers the fight or flight response in us. And when we are sleep deprived, this is the part of the brain that actually amplifies by 60% the emotional reactivity in us. So the question is that why does this happen? Why do we have this emotional reaction which is so amplified when we don't get enough sleep? So there is this another part in our brain called as the prefrontal cortex, is like right here. It is known for rational, logical thinking. So this part, prefrontal cortex, along with the amygdala, they up together, and actually prefrontal cortex is the one that using its rational thought, it kind of has this inhibitory control over amygdala, over having this balanced emotional reactions. And this kind of only happens when we get enough 8 to 9 hours of sleep. But when we don't get this proper sleep, when we are sleep deprived, it's kind of like amygdala is the accelerator and prefrontal cortex is the brake. But when we don't get enough sleep, the brake doesn't function really well. And that's the reason why amygdala just goes out of control, our emotions go out of control and creates havoc for us. So insufficient sleep doesn't exactly amplify the negative emotions in us. It actually causes extreme mood swings. So we just have highs and lows. Again, I'm just going to give a disclaimer that this is not supposed to be mixed with bipolar disorder. That's a disorder. It's a mental disorder. It's totally different. So along with emotional reactions and mood swings, insufficient sleep has been linked with aggression, bullying, and even behavioral problems in children across all ages. And even these brain scanning experiments have shown that insufficient sleep or sleep and psychiatric illnesses are linked in some way, have a relationship. Like, there is no psychiatric illness in which sleep is normal. So this is kind of true in depression, anxiety, bipolar disorder, schizophrenia even, also PTSD. I'm not going to speak much about the mental illnesses in this video because I don't know a lot about it. So I don't want to talk about something I'm not really sure of. So once I know more about it, I'll definitely make an updated video on this. Coming back to the all-nighter, not sleeping and studying thing, let's come back to that. There was a study conducted which showed that when we don't sleep, whatever we have studied or whatever our memory should be formed, it doesn't like get formed properly. We forget a lot of things, so it causes forgetfulness when we don't sleep. There was a study conducted on that, I think in 2006. If I'm not wrong, 2006, when a study was conducted where students were divided into two groups. One was the sleep group and the other one was the sleep deprived group. And after they were sleep deprived, both of these groups were actually asked to learn a couple of facts with MRI brain scanning on, and that was like taking snapshots of their brain while they were trying to learn things, the facts. Then they were asked to give a test on it just to see how much they have learned. But before they gave this test, they were given 2 nights of recovery sleep, and then they were asked to take the test again while taking snapshots of their brain. So what they found was that the students who were sleep deprived, they had 40% less ability to cram things in their brain as compared to the people or students who had a proper 8 to 9 hours of sleep. So why does this happen? So there is this part of our brain called as hippocampus, which actually converts, the right word would be consolidate. So it converts whatever we have studied or whatever memory that we have, like the short-term memory, into long-term memory. I've spoken about all of this in the memory video, so you can check that out if you like. So normal memory gets converted or consolidated into this long-term storage when we are sleeping. So when we are not sleeping, when we are not getting our proper sleep, this doesn't happen. And that's the reason why whatever we have studied, it just poof, it's gone. We don't remember it for long. Also, I read somewhere, I don't remember where I get so much of information from. It's not even in my script. But procedural memory, I spoke about this in memory. What procedural memory is, it's basically any kind of muscle memory. You know what you call it as muscle memory? Like we learn to play a guitar, any musical instrument or any sports, our writing, all of that is procedural memory. So our procedural memory also gets, it strengthens when we are sleeping, because we tend to dream about this. Like maybe, for example, if you're practicing guitar, if you practice guitar, if you go to sleep, in your REM sleep stage, you're actually practicing to play the guitar. You may not actually see it, like you may not remember the dream, but that does happen. So our brain kind of keeps working in the back when we are actually sleeping. So it's not, this is not just true about semantic memory, which is like a studying memory, whatever we study, that's semantic memory, but it is also true for procedural memory. So both of these memories don't get strengthened, they don't consolidate into long-term storage. After saying so much about the brain and what it does to our brain, I'll just give one thing about physiological part. Like there has been a lot of research on this as well, where lack of sleep has been linked to cardiovascular diseases, Alzheimer's disease, cancer, obesity, weak immune system, and I think shorter lifespan in general. So sleep is like the third pillar of good health alongside diet and exercise. watch my other videos on sleep, like this video and subscribe if you haven't already, and I'll see you next Friday with another psychology video. Thank you.